this team.
Thank you very much. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for your kind welcome. I've got two things just by way of additional things. Before we start, the first on the table, you'll see the facsimiles of the Musical Museum, a picture of old Neil Gow, the great fiddler from Inver, on the Hunter's book, The Fiddle Music of Scotland, Glenn's collection of Scottish dance music, the complete collection of the Gow music, and funny enough, it looks the least valuable, probably is the most valuable, and is also the biggest for you to take out under your coats tonight, is the 1799 signed repository by Neil Gow and son, signed by Nathan Gow. These are really the major ones. I don't have the other large collectors, obviously don't have room. We'll be concentrating on these tonight. Also behind me, I've done, and I'm not very good at art, as you can well see, but what I've tried to do here is to see in terms of time scale where the different people are going to fit in. I've started from 1670 here up to 1850 here. Now, there is where Robert Burns fits in, that small area in there. Starting at the top, you have Rory Dall Morrison, the great blind Rory, the harper from Lewis. Then I've got an Irishman, Turlough Callaghan, the great Irish harper. Burns used music from each of these two players. Then, by way of interest, Lady Nairn, who was a lyricist and composer, running almost parallel for a while there with Burns, but lived much longer. Henry Moore, the Irish lyricist who wrote songs like Believe Me of All Those Endearing Young Charms, hundreds of Irish songs, marvellous man, Henry Moore. He is fitting in again. If you look and see how this all sort of fits together in years, all still during the lifespan of Burns, although Moore is not quite so old at that point. Then old Neil Gow, the fiddle composer, born much before Burns, dies after him. William Marshall, born slightly before Burns, lives long after him. Nathaniel Gow, who was Neil Gow's son, again, fiddler, composer, publisher, quite a long life. Robert Bremner, he was a publisher. You'll hear me speak about him and the tunes he brought in. John Riddle, likewise, in he comes here. Lucy Johnson is a fascinating lady, wrote Captain Cook's Death, and Burns used that for one of his songs. Lucy Johnson actually was married to an Oswald and became the lady of Auchincruge. She's a great fiddle player, but died, you'll see, very young. Didn't actually live as long as Burns in terms of lifespan. Red Rob McIntosh on the bottom, a fiddle player, a wild fiddle player from Edinburgh, ran on his own bands. Now the interesting thing is, if you take Burns in the last part here and draw your line right down, you pick up almost every one of these people. I've done this because when I throw dates at you, they really don't mean anything unless you can see how they fit in. Okay, now that part of the lecture finished. Could I say that I'm delighted to have with me players here from the Aaron Prestwick Suspain Real Society with tenor John Goodwin, and that's not his fee, that is the height he sings at. On the fiddles, we've got John McCulloch, David Martin, Caroline Lambie, Margaret Braid. Then we have on the second fiddles, Willie Murray, Willie Dunlop, Kerry O'Drain, and Lorna Kane. On cello, Tom Melrose, and accordion. And I put accordion in because in the 1800s types of bands, you would not have had accordions, but the music has changed. Tastes have changed, and I've just brought it up to date with an accordion, Jim Broadley. And keeping everybody in order, on the piano, we've got Gordon Cree. Now, they're going to start off with a lively set for the Dashing White Sergeant. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Yay! Woo! Woo! That was first class. Interesting thing about that selection of tunes, and this is what makes a talk like this so complicated. Apart from two tunes which I wrote, which was in that selection, there is not one Scottish tune in it. You see, and this is what really throws you. Because the first tune, The Dashing Witch Art, is actually English. It comes from an opera, which then became part of English dance music, came into Scotland, and the rest are all Irish. But the whole thing is homologated so much, it's difficult to sort out what is what. And that's why I included some of the music here of Callaghan. Because before I hit the fiddles, I would dispose of the great minstrelsy of the clarsach and harp, because that Burns used a lot of that type of material. I think his most famous piece that he used, of course, was from Rory Dahl Morrison. Dahl literally means blind, blind Rory Morrison, who came from Lewis. Now, thing about harpers and fiddlers, you found it in the 18th century, many of them, 17th and 18th century, many of them were blind because they were victims of smallpox. And at that time, one of the roll-on effects of smallpox was blindness. And a blind person living in that era had very little chance of a job, whereas with the touching effect of strings on a harp or a fiddle, not so much even the fiddle as the harp, then they could guarantee themselves a reasonable living. And this happened to blind Rory, and he went over to Ireland and was taught the harp, came back and became the official minstrel of the MacLeods of Skye. He wrote a lot of pieces, but as happens with so many of the compositions and writings of blind people, unless you're a musician to write them down, they're lost after two generations, the tunes have been forgotten. So we don't have too many of these left. But his most famous one, of course, which Burns used as the original tune for A Fond Kiss, one of the most magical, heart-rending love songs of all time, was Rory Dahl's Port, which is just, not only do we drink, it's just Rory Dahl's tune, blind Rory's tune. So here we're going to have it on the piano just to get the feel of this lovely tune, and you can get the words A Fond Kiss and Then We Sever. It's not the tune that you recognize, try it. Say that fortune grieves him while the star of hope she leaves him. Me, nae cheerful twinkle lights me, dark despair around benights me. An absolutely gorgeous tune played in the style of the harp. We hear it so seldom now. It is thought that he met with, was either taught or was taught by, because his lifespan's not easy to pick up, Turlough Callaghan, who was the magic harpist, again blind, from Ireland, 1670 to 1738. And Callaghan was heavily influenced by the classical music of his time, by Vivaldi and Corelli, because living in Dublin, where he went quite frequently, he met with Italian classical musicians who were living in Dublin at the time. And a lot of his music is very influenced when you can hear the classical tradition coming in. And every now and again, you get a snap of the lovely Irish tradition. He seemed to be able to marry the two together. Now, one of his pieces, Una's Waterfall, Burns used for one of his songs, Say Flaxen Were Her Ringlets. And to the same lovely tune, Henry Moore, coming much later now than Burns, was also to do one of his inimitable poems. Now, I leave the harpers at that point and move on to the fiddlers. The fiddle is as old as society in Scotland. I mean, we've got it from Thomas the Rhymer. He wrote, harp and fiddle, both he fanned, the Getern and the Sawtry, lute and ribed, there gone gang, there was all manner of minstrelsy. Now only the fiddle and the rebeck were played with a bow. But he makes mention, Thomas the Rhymer, of the two instruments being in this little band that was playing hundreds and hundreds of years ago. And they were, in fact, two separate instruments. The rebeck, we reckon, is the older of the two. And I have here a kind of a makeup. That was a rebeck, believe it or not. Now, you couldn't really imagine somebody knocking off a bit of Vivaldi with that, with a great amount of heft, you know. But it did play, and there are numerous effigies in some of the old churches, Melrose Abbey, etc., of lady players playing this rebeck. Dr. Henry Farmer, the eminent musicologist, reckoned that a fiddle was, in fact, basically what we're looking at just now, but of much, much rougher style. And we can't really find anywhere where we could draw a picture and say that was a fiddle, because fiddle was used as a generic name after that to cover all kinds of stringed instruments that were played with bows. And it was only really with the historians writing about the time of Mary, Queen of Scots, that we were able to get any news at all about the rebeck and the rebeck type of music. Because Collinson, Francis Collinson, writes a marvellous piece of a story by Brantôme, the French historian and soldier who came to Scotland with the court of Mary, Queen of Scots. Writing in 1560, he said, "There came under the Queen's window 500 or 600 citizens of the town who gave her a concert of the vilest fiddles and little rebecks, which are as bad as they can be in that country. Oh, what melody it was! What a lullaby for the night." Now, this is at Holyrood Palace. Old Johnny Knox, though, he was slightly different. He took a different attitude. He wrote about the same night's music making, and he said that the musicians, as a company of honest men, who with instruments of music gave their salutation at her chamber window. And he adds, "The melody, the Queen alleged, liked her well, and she willed the same to be continued." That's what he said. But the same night she moved her whole cortege from the front of the palace to the back. So we can only assume that the sound of the rebeck and the fiddle that time was something else. We won't go into viols, because you'll hear of viols or viols. They were a 15th century invention, went in three different sizes, a small one that was played in the knee, one that was played like a big viol. They were court instruments with special music written. We never had fiddlers playing viols. The interesting thing, the last of the viol is still to the fore in the form of a double bass. They were tuned in fourths, not like violins in fifths. So from the rebeck and the fiddle, the violin was perfected in Italy by the Amati brothers and the successors, the Guarneri and the Stradivari, from 1520 to 1684. The earliest account in Scotland of a violin is in 1708, when two were put up for sale in Edinburgh, along with some music. But we can more or less say that from the mid-1600s onwards, the fiddlers adapted their playing onto violins. So what we're actually hearing tonight is fiddle music played on a violin. Some people always ask me, what's the difference in a fiddler and a violinist? My answer is always 3 feet. Because two violinists can play 3 feet apart. See how close they sit together. Now, Samuel Pepys, we didn't think Samuel Pepys would come into this, but he actually visited Lord Lauderdale's house in the Borders, and in his diary, in July 1666, reports having dinner at Lord Lauderdale's house and being entertained by a servant playing a violin. So we can assume from the diary of Samuel Pepys, unless he is mixing up fiddle and violin, we can only assume that there were violins around Lord Lauderdale's border home at that time. He makes the same comment, of course, as Brantôme, that he thought the music was pretty horrendous. Now, violin makers abounded. Once the Italians had got the art together, everybody started to get into the act. And when the violin became popular, so too did the publishing of music. Prior to the 1700s, we really only had manuscript music in Scotland. But in 1651, Cromwell captured Edinburgh. In the same year, John Playford, who was a London publisher, produced The English Dancing Master. You'll see this referred to throughout the collection, such as the museum here. The English Dancing Master was 1651, and it went into 18 editions and included several Scottish tunes, many of which had only been known in the earlier Skene manuscript here in Scotland. His son, Henry, then produced in 1700, again in England, a publication of Scottish tunes. It was really of more or less Highland humour sort of attitude. But again, purely Scottish tunes were coming from London. It didn't take long, though, for the Scottish publishers to start doing their own works. So now we're going to look at the type of stuff these publishers were doing. Our tempos are, first of all, we have a reel. That's first mentioned in Scotland in 1591. Not very attractive mention. It happened at a witch's coven in North Berwick, where the witches all danced around to a reel, played, I think, with great force and effect at the churchyard. And then the mention of a jig comes from the Vox Borealis of 1641, the tempo of jig. And it tells the story of a fiddler and a singer together entertaining a small group. And the tune that they're performing on the fiddle and singing is Put Up Thy Dagger, Jamie. So we've got Kerry going to give us a once through. This is the old, old tune in the style that it would be then played. Thank you. All forming part of the dance. And then we had this unique snap rhythm of the strathspey, which is particular to Scottish music. First mentioned by Bonnie Prince Charlie whilst travelling through Perthshire in 1745. And it was originally called the strathspey minuet and the strathspey jig. Now, Captain Topham, the English writer who was particularly interested in dancing and dance music, compared the strathspey with a minuet. And he said that it was danced the same way as the minuet, but in a tempo more akin to that of a hornpipe. So we're now going to have the band playing three strathspeys, the Glasgow Highlanders, and the very old one, Jenny's Bobbie, John McAlpin, and two very traditional old reels, Polwart on the Green, and Gin I Wear Where Gaddy Rins, the last one being apparently the tune played by the bands as Cumberland made his way from Aberdeen to Culloden. Well. Thank you. And we would like to look at the time of the collapse of the Darien-Ordarian scheme and the financial disaster that that had on Scotland. The Union of the Parliaments hadn't done a lot more for Scotland, but for whatever reason, with the Union of the Parliaments in 1707, Edinburgh became the mecca for the young gentry and nobility, and they enjoyed meeting, drinking, and dancing. In 1705, Beau Nash instituted in Bath a public dance assembly. The same year, the Horn Club in Edinburgh was founded and started the event of masked balls. There then followed in 1710 private assembly dances in the West Bow, in the street leading from the grass market to the lawn market. Because of the beggars and the drinking that went on there, it quickly became unsuitable, and the assembly moved further down High Street to the new assembly close at 142 High Street, Edinburgh. You can still see that yet, just up from the Tron Church on the left-hand side. If you go straight through, you come to the Advocates Library. Now, these assemblies all started about 6 p.m. and went on till about 9 with a break for refreshments, and after that, the dancing finished about 11 o'clock. Now, these dances, assemblies, which is all these words, assembly hall, all comes from this original idea of dance. Now, the model of Bath was followed meticulously with the little books for dances and the ladies with gloves, and you can see how the gentlemen, most some of them were dressed. I mean, when you think people are embarrassed putting their kilts on nowadays, what they could have been in these days was horrific. There's a marvellous lady, Evelyn Hood, wrote a slight, it's a very short thing. It says, "The high fashion of Bath was thereupon set down in the High Street of Edinburgh, which seems a little like setting a bunch of roses in a midden. But the High Street and the new assembly at the back of Patrick Steele's Close between St. Giles and the Tron Kirk," that's the new assembly close, "was the midden head the Scottish gentry were used to, and they flocked to the assembly." Oh, my God. Topham, that I was really telling you about earlier, he has a marvellous bit of watching one of these assemblies. It says, "A Scotsman comes into an assembly room as he would into a field of exercise, dances till he is literally tired, possibly without ever looking at his partner, or almost knowing who he dances with. In most countries, the men have a partiality for dancing with a woman. But here, I have frequently seen four gentlemen perform one of these reels, seemingly with the same pleasure and perseverance as they would have done had they the most sprightly girl for a partner." And then the king bit comes. "They give you the idea that they could, with equal glee, cast off round a joint stool or set to a corner kitchen cupboard." It seemed to be a fairly solitary evening that they all seemed to have, but they obviously thoroughly enjoyed themselves. Now, the 1700s in which these assemblies were all happening was, of course, and I don't need to tell anybody here, the great time of brilliance of both the literary, the medical, the philosophical, all this stuff. This was taking off in Edinburgh, and music was really no different. And they decided that, just with what I call the golden era coming in, that they would build a new assembly hall, which they did, and it's still there yet, in George Street. They started to build it in 1783. Cornerstone was placed, and it was to that hall, once it was completed, that the beautiful and celebrated Duchess of Gordon, daughter of Sir William Maxwell of Monreath, took Robert Burns on his first visit to Auld Reekie in 1786. Now, the tunes that were played at these assemblies, we're now going to give some idea of the slight change in the fiddle tune. We have two slow airs, well, slowish tunes. One is called "My Love Become My Love Loves Bonnie When She Smiles on Me," and the second one is "She Griped at the Greatest Stoat." Now, these two tunes became changed into "The Flowers of Edinburgh" and "The East Nuke of Fife." So could we have the slow tunes as a demonstration? Thank you. Now, I'm going to curtail this part because there are so many publishers coming into the scene now in Scotland that I shall restrict myself to the most important. William Thomson, he was a Scot, published in 1725 the Orpheus Caledonius with a two-volume edition in 1733 containing 100 songs, but nearly all capable of being danced either as jigs or as reels. In 1726, there were two publications in Edinburgh of Scottish music arranged for groups of musicians. And in 1734, the famous James Oswald, a native of Inferman, published a book of minuets. This was followed in 1741 by his collection of curious Scots tunes. Now, he left Edinburgh to seek his fortune in London, which was by that time much influenced by Scottish culture. From London, between 1743 and 1759, he published 12 volumes of tunes, totaling 550 tunes altogether. And ironically, he called the huge collection the Caledonian Pocket Companion. So it must have been colossal. And you'll see references in many of them, Burns collectors, pieces of the songs, to these pieces, these books, the Caledonian Pocket Companion of Oswald and to the Orpheus Caledonius. There were numerous other ones. There was Robert Bremner down here in blue. He was publishing at the same time, but I'll deal with him later on when we deal with the specific tunes. Because the publishers really don't come in quite so strongly into the mix tonight, as do the individual players. Again, time does not allow me to go into the great stories of some of the marvellous old fiddlers. The one, Petey Burney from Kinghorn, 1635, Cousin Burns, who wrote the Old Man's Mayor's Deed. The very colourful James McPherson, the freebooter, who was born in 1675 to a gypsy woman and a local laird. He was caught, sentenced to death, and the Earl of Grant was sent, word was sent to him to issue a pardon, which he did. But the magistrates in Banff, being a very famous place where the accordionist comes from over there, in their wisdom decided that poor Jim McPherson had to die, so they just turned the clock an hour forward. And as the reprieve was coming in over the Braes of Banff, unfortunately, James swung into eternity forever. Burns actually writes... The story was that he actually wrote his fiddle tune called McPherson's Farewell as he was standing on the gallows. Now, I find that incredible to think, because it's a grand tune. And I mean, how you could be so happy with a rope round your neck, you know, about to take a 2 or 3 foot drop is beyond me. But anyway, Burns got the tune, McPherson's Farewell, and he wrote, "Farewell, ye dungeons, dark and strong, the wretch's destiny. McPherson's time will not be long on yonder gallows tree." We have umpteen other fiddlers mentioned by Burns, Johnny McGill from Girvan, John Bruce, but the great fiddler came along, Neil Gow, that is the man whose picture's on the front of that book. Born in Inver, in Perthshire, in 1727, the son of a plaid weaver. His cottage still there in Inver, you can go and visit it. And he died in 1807, so you see he's quite an old man. He's second below Burns, the small red one, right, the first below Burns, that's Neil Gow. He died an old man and is buried in Little Dunkeld Graveyard. I have the privilege of being one of the trustees of the Neil Gow Trust that tries to preserve some of the music like this and look after the grave and things. He began playing at a very early age and in fact joined in 1745 the rebellion. But he's like a lot of fiddlers in history, he didn't get very far before he ran back home again. I don't think he actually got as far as Preston Pans, which is maybe good for us because he won championships, he was a marvellous solo player, was not a self-taught player, he had been taught by John Cameron and eventually beat him in open competition. His patron became the Duke of Athol, and he gave many performances there in the Duke of Athol's home to friends and guests of the Duke. He and his brother Donald, who played the cello, were the sort of equivalent at that time of a very small group that you would have nowadays, like a guitar and a piano playing at weddings. But they were so famous at it that people would phone him up and ask when Neil Gow was free so that they could organise a wedding or another social function. That's if they could organise a wedding. Well, never mind, anyway. That far ahead without a problem. And he charged 15 shillings, which in 1740 or 1750 was a lot of money. 15 shillings, 75 pence for playing at a wedding when wages were extremely low. He was more of a performer and very famous as a performer than he was or as a composer, but he left us some marvellous dance tunes and beautiful slow airs. They were carefully noted down by Gow's wife. Now, Burns met Neil Gow on his Highland tour, and Gow was persuaded to play for him. And in response, Burns wrote a poem to him in 1787, "A Fiddler in the North, among the trees where humming bees at buds and flowers were hinging o', all Caledon drew out her drone and to her pipe was singing o'. 'Twas Pibroch sang Strathspey and Reels, she dirled them off foo dearly o', when there came a yell o' foreign squeals that dang her tapsel teary o'." This was an influence of continental music coming into Scotland, which we've seen and in the fiddle world have been experiencing until about 20 years ago, where it was considered impolite to play fiddle music, but as long as you could play Handel, Vivaldi, that was all right. But to play Scottish music was sort of looked down, and that no longer applies, I'm glad to say, in Scotland. But this is Burns making reference to this. He met Gow again in Dumfries and penned another marvellous song to him. Thrice welcome, King or Ant and Reel, whar is the bard to Scotia leal? Wha wadna sing o sic a cheel and sic a glorious fiddle, making reference to Gow's fiddle. At the end of the meeting between Gow and Burns, they went to the pub and had a few drinks. Now, things have never changed with that. Fiddles and pipers have got a kind of straight line to a pub after a performance. And I believe it was in the pub that Gow was persuaded to play his famous lament for the death of James Murray of Abercairney, to which Burns eventually penned the song The Lament. So here we've got The Lament for Abercairney. Nathaniel Grau, the purple one coming down here, was almost ages with Burns, and he hadn't really developed his playing skills and his arrangement skills when Burns was looking for that type of fodder, shall we say. But Lady Nairn, on your blue line up here, was older, and in fact Lady Nairn wrote a tremendous number of her pieces to music by Nathan Gow, the most famous being, of course, Callar Herron, while by MacCallar Herron. She was the lady on her own band that did songs like The Auld Hoose and Rowan Tree. But we're not dealing with Lady Nairn tonight, we're dealing with Burns. Nathan was a highly trained player, composer and performer, played in the famous Red Rob Macintosh band, the one down the bottom here, at the assemblies in Edinburgh, and eventually became leader. He travelled all over. He was a player of the violin, a player of the harpsichord. He was even a king's trumpeter at one time in Edinburgh. He visited London, played at private parties given by King George IV, came down to Coylesfield House outside Ayr, and there, although we won't play it just now, composed a beautiful piece called Coylesfield House. It was never used for any songs, but it was one of the most beautiful of the Scottish slow airs, but time does not permit us to go into that. As I've said, he wrote Callar Herron, which is a lovely story of Callar Herron. It's all about the fisherwife's call in Edinburgh, Callar Herron, while by my Callar Herron, that funny fisherman. That's the fisherwife's call as she goes along George Street, heading towards St. Andrew Square, running east to St. Andrew Square. And he heard the New Haven Fisher wife singing this. And then he heard the bells of the St. Andrew's Church pealing out, bah, 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 bah. He married the two together. And if you listen to it, you'll hear the Fisher wife, the part, coming along. Then you hear the bells. And then you hear two other Fisher wives singing a variation of the first theme in the square. And eventually we'll get back to the original measure. And the original lady gets to the square. So there's three Fisher wives in the square and the bells. You're full of useless information now. You know, it's a fascinating story. It's not just all about fresh herring from the Forth as he wrote it. Now, the Gows had it all their own way in Edinburgh. They were commercial. They had the bands. They published profusely. I mean, they see the size of books like that, and that's not all the... The big book is a total collection, but hundreds and hundreds of tunes in that. But they didn't really have it their own way, although from a publishing point of view, they did. There was always competition to be band leaders, but William Marshall came along and really was the doyen of the fiddlers of the 18th century. He was born in 1748 at Fochabers, like Neil Gow. But Gow was 21 years old, remember, when Marshall was born. The two of them came from fairly poor parentage. Eventually, Marshall, with a very high IQ, became butler to the Duke of Gordon and remained in his service until his death. He was fascinated in music, fascinated in astronomy, and fascinated in making clocks of all things. He composed profusely, but in all fairness, his compositions were extremely difficult. He favored flat keys, B-flat, E-flat, A-flat, which is really not the type of key that a fiddle player enjoyed playing. And he wrote pieces that were heavily influenced in the 18th century by continental music, continental influence. Same way as going back, Carlin had done, you know, almost a century before. And when he got into Scottish music, it was the slow spay that he favoured. And I think his most famous one, of course, is Miss Admiral Gordon's spay, to which Burns penned, "Oh, the Erts, the wind can blow, I dearly loo the West." After Marshall, only 10 years after his death, was born J. Scott Skinner. Born James Skinner, was taught by a man called Scott. He adopted the middle name. Almost a continuation of fiddle playing, you see it coming through. And Skinner was the most famous of the 19th century and early 20th century players. Born in Bankery, highly trained musician, he went away and became a member of Dr. Mark's Little Men. He was the most prolific of all Scottish composers. Composed, I think, between 500 and 600 tunes, something like that. It's an incredible number of tunes, and every one almost a masterpiece. When he went away with Dr. Mark's Little Men, he went down to England, and during his few years there, they toured 600 towns. So you could imagine that was 600 different performances they gave over a number of years. And during that time, Dr. Martin had them trained by Charles Rougier, a French violinist with a Halle orchestra, who had also studied at the Paris Conservatoire. So Skinner came back to Scotland, a young man with incredible violin technique that he'd learned in England, but still with the music of the Gows, the music of Marshall, the music of Bremner, all these people instilled within him. Came home, and his father became, following an accident, became a dancing teacher in the Northeast, and Skinner went in as a fiddle player. Skinner was one of the great professional violin players, oblique fiddle players, that Scotland's ever had. He was the first fiddler ever to go on tour, and I mean, his program was Paganini, followed by Mozart, followed by the Laird of Drumblair. He rattled the whole lot together and gave a marvellous evening's entertainment. He was invited with Sir Harry Lauder, this is fascinating, very few people know this, to appear at the opening of the London Palladium in 1911. Now, he was a very old man then. Lawther wasn't that old. And the two of them took part at the London Palladium. Every time I see Bruce Forsyth, you know, I think, Scott, man, can imagine an old fiddler walking on the stage there. Anyway, it wouldn't go down too well. He died in 1927, exactly 200 years after Neil Gow was born, if you work that out. So within that area, we cover all the great fiddlers. Fiddling from then on has changed. We've had the influence of a war, two wars, which brought jazz in. We've had fiddling coming back on the scene. We've had marvelous accordionists starting up, like Jimmy Shand, whose name is as well known as now over the world as Neil Gow's was in Scotland at its time. We've had all this happening, and now we have a young man on the solo field, and we have Strathspian Reel Societies and the Scottish Fiddle Orchestra on the orchestral field, carrying on the tradition of fiddle music. The young man is, of course, Ali Bain. I mean, it's a household word everywhere now. Appears on television with Phil Cunningham, appears in Hogmanay shows. A lovely chap, I know Ali extremely well, but his influence is in the Shetland music, the Canadian music, and the Cree Indian music that is so popular today with the younger people. And I would like to just end this part of the talk with the three young ladies playing French. Thank you.
well done.
Well done, well done, well done. Okay, right. Can I borrow somebody's fiddle? Right, no. Right, can we start with the lady on my left here. No? You're playing this fiddle and you're playing the bow away up here, you know. I could do that with a toothbrush, you know what I mean? Honestly, really, when you try it up here, it's difficult, and it'll take a while to get the swing, but the further up the bow you can go, the more aggression you can actually get into the tune. So you turn the jig, you know, you've got... The further up the bow, try it for you, further up the bow, just a wee bit further. Mm-hmm. Up, yeah. I know it's difficult, just keep trying, that's fine. That's it! Relax, great. Now we'll try the most impossible bit, where you do the whole thing up in that wee bit. No, you'll never ever do it like that. But by going to the extreme, we'll maybe try and get it. Try it. Now try the three if you're there. Take it in the... What's a foot in metric? I'm never very good at this. You know what I mean? There you go. Whatever I said before. Try and do the whole tune in that bit there. I know it's difficult. It won't sound good. But it's amazing. Right, here we go again. 1, 2, 3, 4. Now point the different tree. But go halfway up the bow this time. And we've gone to both ends, so we'll go halfway up. Now point the first note. With these bars. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4. Great. Now the whole lot of you together. You all know that tune. There we go, right? The three of them. Right. Here we go. A chord in A and then we're away. 1, 2, 3, and five. Da 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 dee da dee dee da 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 da. Right, okay, sorry, right. Okay, we're going to go through them. You're only 8 bars each measure, and A major, and then D, which is Rotten Jelly, and then into the A minor with the Rexical there. We chord at the beginning again, piano design, don't worry. 1, 2, 3, and pa, pa, ra, da, da, da. E minor. Well done, bravo. Well done. Well done. Ladies and gentlemen, this part of the talk is dealing with fiddle music and its connection with Robert Burns. I think it would be prudent, because of the strong connection between the Gows and the Burns poems, that we, or should we say, the golden era music and the Burns poems, that we should start with a selection of jigs from the band from the Gow collections. Now, the collections, they're all in here, and these are the very old jigs. They were not new. They were not composed by Gow, any of the Gow. Well, some of them were by the Gows, but a lot of them were probably 100 years old before these collections came in. So if we could have the band and a jig from the Gow collections, that'd be marvelous. Thank you. Gentlemen, in a letter to Charles Sharp in 1790, Burns writes, "I am a fiddler and a poet, and you, I am told, play an exquisite violin and have standard tastes in belles lettres. The other day, a fellow catgut gave me a charming Scotch air of your composition. I was pleased with the tune, and taking up the idea, I have spun it into the three stanzas enclosed. Whenever I feel inclined to rest myself on my way, I take my seat under a hedge, laying my poetic wallet on the one side and my fiddle on the other." Now, this statement by Burns seems, in my opinion, to sum up the whole connection between Burns and the music. If he is inspired, the words flow, the catalyst is there, whether it be words for tunes or tunes for words. Now, we know that his sister, Mrs. Begg, admitted that Burns was never greatly accomplished as a performer on the fiddle. He had a deep love of music and could diligently, when required, write down the tunes, although it's doubted whether he actually composed any tunes. There is a popular theory that he actually wrote one of the tunes, but it's not confirmed to any great degree. He had a wide acquaintance with players and composers, particularly in the Southwest, and drew from them very successfully. With Robert Bremner, the publisher here, in blue, through his time, his tune, in his book, the tune The Miller's Wedding, gave Burns Coming Through the Rye, as well as giving him Rothie Murch's Rant. And it also gave him I'll Gang Nae Mair to Yon Tune, which produced Burns's two songs, I'll Aye Co In by Yon Tune, and Oh What Ye Was in Yon Tune. Robert Riddle, who died in 1794, being Captain Robert Riddle of Glen Riddle, was well acquainted with Burns. Riddle, in 1794, published a collection of Scottish, we would call it now Galwegian, and border tunes. Burns used at least three of these, the most famous being Rattlin' or Roarin' Willie, the composition of John Cowan from Newton Stewart. Another of Riddle's informants was John Bruce, who provided, it is said, Burns with Whistle o'er the Leavitt and Whistle and I'll Come to You, My Lad. John Riddle, a blind fiddler from Ayr, who's from 1718 to 1795, apart from leaving us many tunes for the dance, provided Burns with an air called Finlayston House, to which Burns penned, Fate gave the word, the arrow sped. From John McGill, fiddler in Girvan, he took the tune Johnny McGill for his words, Oh, wilt thou go wi' me, sweet Tibby Dunbar. From John French, 1753 to 1803, a man originally from Cumnock, but latterly in Edinburgh, Burns endeavoured to get copies of his tune sets. One of French's compositions was a tune called Major Logan's Frolic. Now, Major William Logan of Ayr was himself a noted fiddler with several pieces published in the Gow collections, as well as in the book by Simon Fraser in 1816. He was the proud recipient of the epistle by Burns to him of 30th October 1786, which gave us the immortal lines, Hail Therm-inspiring Rattlin' Willie. Therm means guts or strings, or in this case, fiddle strings. Hail Therm-inspiring Rattlin' Willie, though fortune's road be rough and hilly, to every fiddling rhyming billy we never heed, but take it like the unbracked filly, prude o'er speed. And the unforgettable couplet, Hail be your heart, hail be your fiddle, lang may your elbuck jink and diddle. There were a number of marvellous players down the coast here. One was Matthew Hall, who was for 45 years a cellist for dance bands between Ayr and Glasgow. His venues included Coilsfield House and also Eglinton Castle, close by here, where Lord Eglinton, a noted fiddle player and composer, occasionally joined in the band playing his fiddle. Matthew's lifelong fiddling partner was a Highlander called James McLaughlin, the fiddler addressed by Burns in his Briggs of Ayr. Oh, had McLaughlin Therm again, oh, had McLaughlin Therm-inspired sage been there to hear this heavenly band engage, we're talking about a band that had been playing, when through his dear Strathspeys they bore with Highland rage, or when they struck old Scotia's melting airs, the lover's raptured joys or bleeding cares, how would his Highland lug be nobler fired, and even his matchless hand with finer touch inspired. So from the band that we're talking about in the Briggs of Ayr to the band we have here, two Strathspeys and reels, each one used by Burns, fashioned by him into everlasting song. We have Green Grow the Rashes O. You're relieved sitting there thinking I was changing again. I know them well, don't worry. Green Grow the Rashes O, which comes from the Stralach manuscripts of 1627. So Green Grow the Rashes O is a very, very old tune. And then John Bruce's Whistle or the Lavert, followed by the three reels, Miss Farquharson's reel from Bremner, that's again Bremner down here, which became Under Burns' Hand, My Love, She's But a Lassie Yet, Corn Rigs, from what I was telling you earlier, the Orpheus Caledonius of 1733, and Duncan Gray from the, if you remember, the heavy, the Caledonian Pocket Companion of 1751. Each one of these tunes carefully noted, preserved, and then taken by Burns. Thank you. Marvellous story, ladies and gentlemen, of the original tune Dainty Davy, chosen by Burns for his own song There Was a Lad Was Born in Kyle. These words are now sung to an equally old tune contained in almost all the collections, but titled in the Gow collection of 1799, that's the brown one there, as Watson's Scotch Measure. That's the one, There Was a Lad Was Born in Kyle. Actually, it was set as a Scotch measure or a reel. That's Watson's Scotch Measure. But the original tune, Dainty Davy, tradition has it that Dainty Davy was composed on the Reverend David Williamson's begetting the daughter of Lady Cherry Trees with child, whilst a party of dragoons were searching her house to apprehend him for being an adherent to the Solemn League and Covenant of 1643. I'm quoting, this is not my words, I'm quoting. The pious lady put a lady's nightcap on him and put him to bed with her daughter. Oh my! He was nicknamed Dainty Davy from then on. Now, I only discovered that quote. That's a marvellous story. Now, whether Burns reacted, knowing Burns, whether he was inspired by this story or not, I don't know, but he wrote no less than 3 songs to this tune, There Was a Lad, Meet Me on the Warlock Now, and Lovely Was She by the Dawn. Now, from the folk tune Haker through Burns, we have Up with the Carles of Dyset. From Kenmure's On in a War, an adapted song, we got a song of the same title. From the dance tune Merrily Danced the Quaker's Wife, we actually get 3 songs. Thine Am I, My Cloris Fair, Come Read Me Dame, Come Tell Me Dame, and Blithe Hae I Been on Yon Hill. Now this is where we're going to try and show how Burns could take a dance tune and turn it into a song. So here we have, as they would play it at a dance, at the assembly dance, just the reel, the jig, sorry, Merrily Danced the Quaker's Wife. You got it new, all right? Okay, 1 and 2. Bum, bum, hey, dum. Burns had this ability to hear a perfectly simple dance tune and say, I'll change the tempo, I'll make this into a lovely... He could almost hear, Thine am I, my Cloris Fair, a lovely, lovely song. Now, from the ranting Highlandman in Campbell's collection of airs comes My Love Was Born in Aberdeen. From Rothiemurch's rant in the Bremner and McGlashan collections comes Lassie with the Lint-White Locks and Fairest Maid on Devon Banks. From the slow Strathspey, Lennox Love to Blantyre, the most emotive, O Wert Thou in the Call Blast, which was to be almost Burns' last song, and the music which Mendelssohn subsequently composed to this beautiful set of words, unfortunately superseded the beautiful but rather rustic Scottish measure. Now here is the old tune as it was adapted, Lennox Love to Blantyre. And if you can just think of the words, O Wert Thou in the Call Blast, feeding through these words. Right, John. Right. Wert Thou in the Call Blast, on yonder lea, on yonder lea, my plighty, to the angry air, I'd shelter thee, entitled I Walk an O, came Long, Long the Night, dedicated to Jean Lorimer, Cloris, essentially original Burns. But he also gave us a tidied up version of one of David Herd's traditional fragments. Herd's version was, O what, what, O what, and weary, sleep I can get nane for thinking on my dearie. All the night I wak, all the day I weary. Sleep I can't get nane for thinking on my dearie. And in under Burns's hand, we finished up with I Walk a Know. John, please. Musical inspiration are not always obvious. He wrote A Rosebud by My Early Walk to A Slow Suspay, composed by his friend David Siller, who became the very first vice president of this Irvine Burns Club, and I believe his chair's downstairs, am I right with that? Now, Siller was a fine amateur fiddler and had been one of the poet's teachers of the fiddle. His tune, called The Rosebud, is an excellent example of the rugged minor slows to spay, but how the delicacy of Burns's words could have been inspired by the piece is difficult for me to imagine. That's not to say you can imagine it, but it's a lovely, lovely tune in its own right, and yet inspired words of a completely different texture. So here Caroline is going to give us The Slow Suspay by David Siller, A Rosebud. A Slow Suspay, I would explain, is not a dance. It's really a half between a slow air and a suspay. It's something to be listened to rather than danced. I think you can probably hear A Rosebud by My Early Walk, but it's a very driven rhythm. Maybe Burns heard it differently. I don't know. I'm only going by the music that we have available. In my opinion, the tune, The Shepherd's Wife, There's even some debate as to whether it is actually the shepherd's wife. It's written, called that in the books, but there are two different versions of the tune, to which the words are presently set, being a slowed version of an old 6/8 jig, much more complement the mood of the words, and has probably done more to preserve the song than had the original tune been maintained. So could we have That's the Rosebud? And Lucy Johnson, it's the very short line down here, born in Berwickshire in 1765, became, following her marriage to Richard Oswald of Auchincroove, a great friend and patroness of the Bard. A brilliant fiddler and prolific composer during her short lifetime, she provided Robert Burns with a slow air entitled Captain Cook's Death. This he used for his song of anguish following the death of Mary Campbell, Thou Lingering Star. It's a lovely tune which we'll now hear, Captain Cook's Death. Thou lingering star, with lessening ray, that loves to greet the early morn. Again thou usherest in the day, my Mary from my soul was torn. Oh Mary, dear departed shade, where is the place of blissful rest? Seest thou thy lover lowly laid? Hearest thou the groans that rend his breast? Lovely tune, Captain Cook's words. Hey Tatty Tatty, the tune inspired Scots Wha Hey, the reel, the drummer, inspired the tailor he came here to sew. The reel of Stumpy became wap and row, and the Caledonian Hunt's Delight by James Miller of the Teind Office in Edinburgh. He was a solicitor, a writer in Edinburgh. The Teind Office is actually still in existence at Register House, and it had to do with the collection of tithes and teinds from land. James Miller wrote the tune, The Caledonian Hunt's Delight, and it's printed in Gow's second collection. And that gave us three songs. There was a time, but old time was then young. Why, thy lover, and the everlasting ye banks and braes of Bonnie Doon. Are they in? Same name. Copies of which song Burns sent to Mrs. Dunlop and also to Clorinda. So he actually, the old original tune, as we would think it would be, was the original setting for My Love's Like a Red, Red Rose. To Gow's lament for the death of his brother, Burns penned, there's a youth in this city, it were a great pity. And to the lament for the death of the Reverend James Murray, Esquire of Abercarney, he gave us the beautiful song, where braving angry winter storms, the lofty ochils rise, far in their shade my Peggy's charms first blessed my wandering eyes. A copy of that song he sent to Peggy Chalmers in November 1787, along with the song My Peggy's Face, My Peggy's Form. But his greatest original love song to his beloved wife, Jean Armour, who all the hurts the wind can blow, is from William Marshall's Slows to Spey, Miss Admiral Gordon's to Spey. Now, here's Marshall, the Green Line, stretching across, longer than Gough, almost as long before Burns as after him. This is the clockmaker, this is the man that played in flats, the doyen of the fiddlers. And this tune, Miss Admiral Gordon's to Spey, is a very fine air by Marshall and beautifully constructed. And Caroline will now play the Slow Suspies. Slow Suspies are murder on a fiddle, I can tell you that. I admire as you would have been working at it. So here we have the Slow Suspie, Miss Admiral Gordon's Suspie. Thank you, Caroline. When manipulated to Burns's words, the air becomes even more beautiful than it is the Slows to Spey. But so also, would I suggest, becomes the poignancy of the written words of our national bard, John, who are the Yeats. Into all the arts. Gough's Major Graham of Inchbrakey, being manipulated into My Love's Like a Red, Red Rose, presents me personally with a problem absent from any other marriage of words and fiddle tunes. And in the absence of seeing the actual musical notation, if any, submitted by Burns, would have to lay the problem that I have here at the doors of the publishers. It was first published by Urbani, a musician in Edinburgh, in April 1794, in his selection of Scots songs, and later by both Thomson and Johnson. According to a note on the advertisement, Urbani states that Burns had collected the words from a country girl but begged Urbani to set them to music in the style of the Scots tune. Urbani was an extremely accomplished musician, but more interested in the art music form than the simpler form of the folk tradition. By altering Gower's original notation in the first measure of the tune, the publishers finished up, in my opinion, not with a smooth-flowing set of lyrics to a free-flowing Scottish air, but instead a rather stilted song coming very close to art form. Now, I know this is a very personal feeling I have about one of the world's great love songs, but here in the form as it appears in the museum and also Urbani, is John to sing Major Graham, the tune by Neil Gow, and the words, "My love's like a red, red rose." Play Major Graham as Neil Gow wrote the tune. And the difference to listen to is the emphasis that we heard in the song there, "Oh, my love's like a red, red," the high note, rose, that. And when you hear the Gow original, then we'll see what you think. attitude you take, ladies and gentlemen, I still feel that as written by Neil Gow, the original tune might have survived with the words longer than it has. A very slight adaptation of the words from "My love's like a red, red rose" to "My love is like a red, red rose" has afforded the tune "Low Down in the Broom," a very old fiddle tune, to carry the song into posterity. Burns was one of the world's greatest lyricists and song collectors. It's freely agreed that many songs attributed to him as originals are beautifully reconstructed earlier folk songs, but conversely, I am of the opinion that many songs which he submitted for publication as having been taken down, in inverted commas, from the singing of some anonymous individual were either completely his or had been so vastly altered as to make them justifiably his. I do not agree with Sir Walter Scott's comments in the Quarterly Review number 1 when he regretted so much of Burns's time was frittered away in compiling and composing for musical collections, and that Burns had forced, that Burns was forced to twist his words into such rhythmical forms as might suit the capricious evolutions of Scotch reels and strathspeys. Indeed, in my opinion, Burns's words have lived on when very many of the capriciously evolved tunes have disappeared from the songs to be supplanted by more fitting melodies from people inspired by the pen of the bard. Now, one example, as we reach the end of this part, ladies and gentlemen, is a lovely song which appears in the museum, and it's "Behold, My Love, How Green the Grove." It's a marvellous song depicting the shepherd's cottage and then a life of elegance and comparing the two. Now, this song was composed by Burns based on a suggestion by Cloris. And his idea was to put it to the tune "My Lodgings on the Cold Ground," a minor tune appearing in Playford's Dancing Master of 1665 and the tune given in the musical museum. Originally written by Matthew Locke, who died in 1677, the minor tune was supplanted in 1775 by a major tune of the same name, and which was used by Henry Moore, back up here again, the Irish lyricist, for "Believe Me," if all those endearing young charms. But how beautifully it suits Bird's words of comparison of the two lifestyles. John, could we have to what we now call the new name, "My Lodgings in the Cold Ground," "Behold, My Love, How Green the Groves"?
The shepherd stops his simple reed.
To do so. But one song will not change, whether it is to Gow's Major Graham of Inchbrakey or to Lowdown in the Broom. So let us close with the love song, my opinion of love songs, My Love's Like a Red, Red Rose, to the second fiddle melody, which will live on either together or probably to another melody, as long as Scotland has got voices to sing. Ladies and gentlemen, the band and John with Lowdown in the Broom and My Love's Like a Red, Red Rose.
Thank you.
such an attentive audience. Thank you.
On your behalf, the appreciation of this evening, it's really been quite a memorable experience. I first heard John Mason playing the fiddle some 28 years ago at the old
Irvine
Folk Club.
I'm just a
bit there,
if you look at that.
Down at the old Irvine Folk Club in the Sun Inn, behind the railway station. When a crowd like this would have had everybody standing room only, and John, I distinctly remember, played a memorable hen's march. That was the same venue where the other contemporaneous Scottish fiddler, Ali Bain, appeared. At the time when Ali would play for the price of a fish supper and his train fare back to Glasgow, I get the impression that we've all moved on just a wee bit since then, but the quality of the music is every bit as good, if not better. I was fascinated in the first part by John's history of Scottish fiddling. I was equally fascinated in the second part when John started to pull together all the Burnsian connections. I was totally intrigued in the middle when John held his mini tutorial. And the three young ladies, with just a few tiny differences in bowing, were instructed how to make their music sound totally different, even to a tuneless ear like mine's. That, I think, is the mark of a true master. That and the fact that he made our three students feel totally at ease and totally part of tonight's band. It's very difficult on an evening like this to thank people individually, so I don't propose to do that quite. There's been all sorts of people involved in making this evening work the way it has. People who organised it, people who worked away behind the scenes, the people who participated, our soloists, especially whether on the fiddle or with the voice or accompanist, John's heavenly band that he tried to tell us don't get to practice much. Now, do you believe that? If they don't practice, John, they're certainly all naturals. But most especially this evening, I think we owe a great debt to John Mason for helping to pull the thing together. Not only was he our presenter, but he was our musical director for the evening. And you probably noticed that very subtly and very quietly, John controlled everything. The mark of a true artist at a master class. Sometimes with a wee bit of panic in his expression, but it was under control, John.
Well, you hadn't noticed.
I don't think it was any mistake that John was awarded the OBE for his services to music. I think we can understand exactly why. John, to you, to all your accompanists, to your helpers tonight, our heartiest vote of thanks for a truly memorable evening.